It just be annoying. The fuck.
Come on, let's get in the highest place tonight. Hallelujah. The Lord is high above the heavens.
The Lord is high above the heavens.
And the story above the nation.
And the story above.
The Lord is high above the heavens.
The Lord is high above the heavens.
All of my life, I've never known you to fail. You remain the same, and wonderful is your name. All of my life, I've never known you to fail. You remain the same, and wonderful is your name.
Hey guys, happy Thanksgiving. It's Lady T here. I am going to do our opening prayer for service today. So if you would join me, I would be very appreciative to have you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much, God, for another Thanksgiving that you have given us. We thank you, Lord God, that all that has occurred this year, that you have allowed us to see yet another day. We thank you, oh Lord, because some people may feel like they don't have anything to be thankful for this day. But Lord, the fact that we are here, the fact that we are still alive, the fact that we are able to still say your name and acknowledge you is enough to be thankful for. So Lord God, I pray and I ask you, those that may not be feeling so thankful on this Thanksgiving, God, that you will comfort their hearts, that you will be the reason, oh God, that we will celebrate today, that if they may have lost a loved one that may not be sitting around the table today or may not be there to enjoy dinner, Lord, allow them to remember the sweet memories that they have shared on previous Thanksgivings before this one. Lord, we thank you most of all that we are able to celebrate you in another worship service. Lord, we ask you, God, that you would be in the midst of the service, Lord. We ask you, God, that you will allow us to have a word that will feed us spiritually, dear Lord. We ask you, dear Lord, that you would be able to comfort us and be whoever and whatever it is that we may need in this hour. Lord God, we thank you. We appreciate you. And we want to say that we love you, Lord. And we are looking forward in great expectation of all that is going to take place on this Thanksgiving day in this Thanksgiving service. It is through and only through the name of Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. Amen.
To Senior Bishop Adam Jefferson Richardson, Jr., Supervisor Connie Spates Richardson, Presiding Elder Elizabeth E. Yates, and the Reverend Dr. William Watley, greetings. On behalf of the churches represented today, we would like to welcome you to the gathering. Our families and our church families share an incredible bond. Although the coronavirus pandemic has limited what we are physically able to do as far as worshiping and fellowshipping together is concerned, it has not hindered our spirit of gratitude and thankfulness to God. So today we gather together virtually to praise God from whom all blessings flow. We gather to hear the songs of joy sang by leading lady LaJoyce Ingraham, to pray prayers of invocation by Lady Tierra Gibson, and to hear the word of God proclaimed in a four-part sermon from the Gospel according to the 22nd chapter of Luke, a passage that reflects on Jesus breaking bread with those closest to him, even in the midst of tumultuous times. We will conclude our gathering with a time of prayer by East Conference YPD President Brittany Bryan. So on behalf of Pastor Newton, Pastor Evans, Pastor Gibson, and Pastor Ingraham, we implore you to assemble your family for the gathering and be blessed.
The Gospel according to Luke, the 22nd chapter, beginning at the first verse from the New Revised Standard Version of the Bible. Now the festival of unleavened bread, which was called the Passover, was near. The chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to put Jesus to death, for they were afraid of the people. And then Satan entered in Judas, called Iscariot, who was one of the 12. When he went away and conferred with the chief priests and the officers of the temple police about how he might betray him to them, they were greatly pleased and agreed to give him money. So he consented and began to look for an opportunity to betray him to them when no crowd was present. Then came the day of the unleavened bread on which the Passover lamb would be sacrificed. So Jesus sent Peter and John saying, "Go and prepare the Passover meal for us that we may eat." And they asked him, "Where do you want us to make preparations for it? "Listen," he said to them, "when you have entered the city, a man carrying a jug of water will meet you. Follow him into the house he enters and say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks you, where is the guest room and where may I eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, already furnished. Make preparations for us there." So they went and found everything as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. My brothers and my sisters, for the time that is yours and mine together, I want to preach from this subject. Guess who's coming to dinner? As many of us are gathered together today, some of us in traditional settings, and some of us in virtual settings, and some of us socially distanced, and some of us with a mask, and some of us with no fear, and all of the virus, we are gathered together, and prayerfully, there has been a meal prepared for us. Prayerfully, there is some fried turkey or some baked turkey. Prayerfully, there is some macaroni and cheese. Prayerfully, there is some collard greens or some turnip greens or some mustard greens. There are some candy yams and some cornbread. There's some sweet potato pies and some red velvet cakes. Prayerfully, wherever you are gathered today at this 10:30 hour, you are waiting on a meal to eat, my brothers and sisters. But family is family. And if your family is like my family, I love them, but we're not all perfect. And there is a contemplation of who all will be there. You will understand that we've got bougie aunties and uncles. We've got cousins that we do and don't like. Some of the cousins will come up smelling a little funny, and we're going to go hang with them. And some of them will come up with a bottle of liquor with it's hanging in the corner, and we'll go hang with them. And somebody's going to pull out the cards and play spades. Y'all ain't going to invite me because I don't know how to play spades. Somebody is going to play the electric slide. Somebody is going to get in an argument. Somebody is going to try to figure out who sits where. Somebody is going to bicker at the table. But brothers and sisters, we'll be thankful and grateful at the fact that we have the ability to gather together one more time. You'll understand that there will be somebody that calls before they come. There will be a black sheep in the family. There will be somebody who married somebody that everybody doesn't like. There will be a family member that calls and says, who all is over there in the midst of the eating, in the midst of the breaking of the bread. There will be somebody who shows up late because they're never on time. There will be what we like call holiday season in the family. My brothers and my sisters will debate where we're going to sit and how we're going to sit and who's going to stand next to who and what time we're going to take the cute pictures, because the family getting together is just about the same everywhere. This year, COVID makes it different. This year, our gathering is not of the same. But in spite of all of that, we've got a reason, a rhyme, and a right, my brothers and sisters, to be thankful. Because although some of us have seen tumultuous times this Thanksgiving season, while some of us have had losses of jobs, and some of us have had losses of loved ones, and some of us have had losses of opportunities, and some of us have not had the opportunity to gather in church since God knows when, can I tell you, in spite of all the L's we've taken, in spite of all the hell we've endured the past 4 years, the election cycle, I'm sorry, I'm talking about Thanksgiving, in spite of all the things we've encountered in the year 2020, no matter who died and who left, there's still a reason to come together and be thankful. Oh, you've got a lot to be thankful for. There's a roof over your head. There's food in the kitchen. There's something to drink. When you woke up this morning, y'all have been thankful that your bed wasn't your cooling board. Your knees still worked and your hands still worked in spite of the arthritis and the pains. Your mind was still all right, even if you had to take a pill to put it back in place. Beloved brothers and sisters, there's a reason to be thankful, because the sun came up and it will go down and it'll come up again. There's a reason that the Lord didn't call you home to get it right, and for that you ought to get together and gather in a place thankfully. The Bible does say that the disciples did not know where they were going to go, and the disciples had to put it together, my brothers and my sisters. They did not know that Judas was in the process of betraying him. And I know that everybody that comes, even though your skin folk don't mean they're your kin folk, I know that sometimes you might say them my mama people or them my wife people. Some of us might have issues inside the family, but we ought to be thankful that there's still a family to be thankful for. Not only is there family to be thankful for, but there's a space prepared for you. And in spite of all that you're going through and all, in spite of all you've been through, there's still a space and a place to gather. There's still room for you to assemble. There's still a time for you to see the face of somebody you love, even if it's over the screen. And you ought to wake up this morning, you ought to clap your hands and stomp your feet and say, thank you, God, for the fact that I still got a place of preparation. Not only do I have a place of preparation that's been prepared for me, and not only do I have people around me that I kind of like and I kind of love, my brothers and sisters, more important, I've got a person to praise. I'm out of here. The preachers are coming behind me. But in this text, in this piece of pericope, in this thing that's put together for us here in the Gospel according to Luke, Luke does not tell us what Jesus was in the middle of all of this. And in my mind, I've got to know that Jesus had already worked it out. That in spite of the betrayal by Judas, he had already worked it out. And in spite of the fact that he had told them that foxes have holes and birds have nests, but the Son of Man doesn't have a place to lay his head. And in spite of them have traveling by boat and by sea, and in spite of them have walking and encountering folk that didn't like them, there was still a place prepared for them in the presence of their enemies. And even in the presence of your enemies, even in the moments where it doesn't seem to all be going right, even in times where it's done a little bit differently, you ought to sit in your living room, ought to sit in your kitchen, watch this on your laptop or your tablet, and be excited that in spite of it all and through it all, my brothers and my sisters, you got to get excited about the person that's coming to dinner. That no matter what you've gone through and what you've seen, there's still somebody coming to dinner. that in spite of all the hell that might have broken out in your family, in spite of all the issues you had, you ought to thank God that there's still somebody coming to dinner. That there is still a way maker coming to dinner. There's still Adam's vindicator coming to dinner. There's still Noah's Ark coming to dinner. There's still Abraham's sacrifice coming to dinner. There's still Moses' burning bush coming to dinner. There's still Joseph's battle axe still coming to dinner. There's still Gideon's fleece still coming to dinner. There's still Samson's power and David's music and Solomon's wisdom still coming to dinner. There's still Jeremiah's balm in Gilead and Ezekiel's wheel in the middle of the wheel coming to dinner. There's still Job's horse pawing in the valley coming to dinner. There is still Matthew's king coming to your dinner. There's still Mark's suffering servant coming to your dinner. There's still Luke's great physician coming to your dinner. There's still John's word made flesh still coming to dinner. And in spite of all you've been through, you ought to throw your head back, throw your hands up, and thank God that Jesus still walks with you, that he still talks with you, that he still prepares a place for you, that he still makes room for you, and he still breaks bread. Guess who's coming to dinner? His name is Jesus, and he's coming to dinner.
Continuing on with the Gospel according to St. Luke, beginning with the 14th chapter and ending with the 23rd verse from the Message Bible, you will hear these words. When it was time, he sat down, all the apostles with him, and said, "You've no idea how much I have looked forward to eating this Passover meal with you before I enter my time of suffering. It's the last one I'll eat until we all eat together in the kingdom of God." Taking the cup, he blessed it, then said, "Take this and pass it among you. As for me, I'll not drink wine again until the kingdom of God arrives." Taking bread, he blessed it, broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you. Eat it in my memory." He did the same with the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant written in my blood, blood poured out for you." Do you realize that the hand of the one who is betraying me at this moment on this table? It's true that the Son of Man is going down a path already marked out. No surprises there. But for the one who turns him in, turns traitor to the Son of Man, this is doomsday. They immediately became suspicious of each other and began quizzing one another, wondering who might be about this. For the time that I have been allotted, we would like to speak from the thought, a thanksgiving worth remembering. Beloved, just this past Tuesday, the school district dispersed for the Thanksgiving holiday. And when the dismissal bell rang, certainly I was the very first one out the door. And as I walked to my car, I saw another one of my colleagues walk into her car. And I asked her, "Friend, what you got planned for this incoming Thanksgiving break?" And she told me that she didn't want to even think about the thought of having anything related to Thanksgiving. She told me that this Thanksgiving will be the very Thanksgiving that she wishes to completely forget. Certainly, I looked in disbelief because I never heard anyone say such a thing about such a joyous holiday. So I inquired more about her rationale and thinking like she thought. She told me, "Well, first and foremost, this year has already been one of the worst years of my life. My husband was laid off. We were evicted from out of our house, and we have up to this point stayed in a hotel And even with this pandemic going on, I have nothing to be thankful for this year and for this Thanksgiving, as well as any other holidays, as far as this Thanksgiving and the rest of this holidays for the year 2020. These holidays are nothing worth remembering for me. And friends, that statement bothered me and forced me to put pen to paper and be aided by the voice of God. And that statement made me realize that every now and again, there comes a time in life, especially in the holiday season, where we feel as though we have nothing to be thankful for. And that time within the holiday season is something that needs to be forgotten as soon as possible. Friends, we're living in times of sickness. We're living in seasons in our lives where we have been globally stricken by a deadly virus that is forcing us to celebrate these holidays in a different and uncomfortable way. We're living in a time where loved one after loved one is getting sick. We're living in the time where loved one after loved one is dying. We're living in the time where friend after friend is getting sick. We're living in a time where friend after friend is dying. What is there to be thankful for in times like these? What is there to be thankful for as we gather at the table this afternoon? Why should I remember anything about this Thanksgiving? Why should I remember anything this Thanksgiving when grandmama ain't here to celebrate with me anymore? Why should I remember this Thanksgiving when I lost a loved one to COVID? Why should I remember this Thanksgiving when I lost my job? Why should I remember this Thanksgiving when I don't feel like praising God with the fruit of my lips? Why should I remember this Thanksgiving when I don't feel as though everything that has breath out praise the Lord? Why should I remember this Thanksgiving and continue to have praises being in my mouth and blessing the Lord at all times? Why should I remember this holiday when these circumstances have shielded me from giving thanks? Why should I remember this Thanksgiving? Yes, I ought to be thankful. Yes, I ought to praise God in the midst of, but there are some realities and there are some circumstances that are going on in my life that are challenging me and preventing me from remembering this Thanksgiving. If that sounds like you, then I'd ask for you to follow me for the next 5 minutes to the upper room. It's Thursday night, a few hours before his arrest and his trial and his death. And in just a few hours, friends, Jesus will no longer be alive. So being that Jesus knows what's about to go down, he tells his disciples to go get somewhere for us to parlay, because we got some things to talk about. We got some things that I need to discuss with you before I'm gone. This is the very last time that they will be with Jesus before he dies. And we know what happens in the midst of this situation. He takes the bread. He gives thanks and breaks it to his disciples and says, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And he does the same thing with the cup and says, "This is the cup. Drink from this cup, because this is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and the everlasting covenant that will be shed for you and for all, so that your sins may be forgiven." Which goes to my very first point out of two. The very first thing in remembering why this is indeed a Thanksgiving worth remembering is simply because of what he's already done. Beloved, this is why this Thanksgiving will be a Thanksgiving worth remembering, because of what he's already done around the time of the very first Thanksgiving. Yes, I know that we're in a pandemic. Yes, I know you may be having Thanksgiving by yourself this year. Mama may not be with you this year. Daddy may not be with you this year. But I'm reminded of what the hymnologist said. He said, when waves of affliction sweep over your soul and sunlight is hidden from view, if ever you're tempted to fret or complain, just think of his goodness to you. Is there anybody on this live stream that can think of God's goodness? Why is we thinking about God's goodness? He woke you up this morning. That's goodness. He started you on your way. That's goodness. He put warm blood running in your veins. That's goodness. He allowed you to get from point A to point B. That's goodness. He allowed you to see another Thanksgiving. That is goodness. All I'm trying to let somebody know on this Thanksgiving morning is when you feel as though you want to complain, when you feel as though you've dropped the ball, when you feel as though there's nothing else going on in your favor, all you got to do is think of his goodness to you. And last reason as to why this Thanksgiving is worth remembering is because simply of God's grace. Friends, after the bread and after the wine, the conversation turns very somber. Jesus says, one of you will betray me. Jesus wants the people to know that there is one person out of this group who has been following me all this time, but at this point is about to no longer follow me again. There is one among you who calls himself a disciple, but is about to do something that is going to alter the history, the very history of time. There is one within the group that will betray me. Jesus knows who that betrayer is. And guess what? That betrayer knows who he is. But can I tell you one thing that I like about Jesus? And that thing is this. When they get to the table, Jesus still invites his betrayer to that same table. Now, just in case you may be looking at this TV a little bit funny and don't understand the significance of sitting at the table, allow me to remind us that Jesus always had a habit of sitting at the table with the wrong folk. Because if we haven't known by now, it speaks volumes when you are at the table sitting with other folk. Because when you're at the table, fellowship is about to commence. When you're at the table, business is about to be handled. When you're at the table, candid conversation is about to be held. And this is why this is important. It's important because there is something about God's grace. And it is that grace that leaves room for those who are unworthy of sitting at that same table. Grace, friends, creates room for those who are unworthy of being in communion with God. Because when I'm not worthy, because when I'm not living right, because when I'm tore up from the floor up, when I'm not praying like how I'm supposed to pray, while I'm not living like I'm supposed to live, it is that table that reminds me that even in the midst of my unworthiness, even in the midst of my struggle, even in the midst of my pain, even in the midst of not serving God like how I'm supposed to, we still can serve a God who allows us to sit at the table when we can't get right. He still allows us to sit at the table when we are struggling to not want to do like what we are called to do. So if you are that family member who can't get right, if you are that uncle that is shunned away from your family because of the drugs that you sell, if you are that cousin who gets shunned away from your family because of your promiscuity, allow me to give you some good news. And that good news is this. It is God's grace that unwavers the bad that we do. It is God's goodness that conquers the wrong that we do. It is God's grace that continues to keep us going. And it was God's grace that'll continue to carry us through this Thanksgiving season. Is there anybody here that's been invited to some tables that they have no business of being in? Is there anybody here that has been placed in jobs that they knew that they were unqualified for? Is there anybody on this live stream that knows that they've been living through some times that they didn't deserve to live in? Because we serve a God that provides us with grace. It's that amazing grace. It's that unmerited grace. It's that unspeakable grace. It's that grace that keeps you. It's that grace that leads you. It's that grace that aids you. And it's that grace that continues to keep us through the midst of this pandemic. For it is through many dangers, tars, and snares that I've already come. And it is by grace that has brought us to another Thanksgiving table. And it is that same grace that will continue to lead us on. So if you feel as though you want to murmur and complain because this isn't the ideal Thanksgiving for you, just remember about what the Lord has already done for you. And remember this, it is by grace that you're able to yet see another Thanksgiving. May God bless you and may God keep you is our prayer. Amen and amen.
Good morning and happy Thanksgiving. It's my pleasure and my honor to participate in this tag team Thanksgiving Day service. I am Lamone Gibson, and it is my pleasure to be a part of this service with my brothers and family. I'll be preaching along with my brothers from Luke 22, and I'm going to pick up at verse 24 and go down to verse 30, reading from the Message version of the Bible. Within minutes, they were bickering over who of them would end up the greatest, but Jesus intervened. Kings like to throw their weight around, and people in authority like to give themselves fancy titles. It's not going to be that way with you. Let the senior among you become like the junior. Let the leader act the part of the servant. Who would you rather be, the one who eats the dinner or the one who serves the dinner? I'm sure you'd rather eat and be served, right? But I've taken my place among you as the one who serves others. You've stuck with me through thick and thin. Now I confer on you the royal authority my father conferred on me, so you can eat and drink at my table in my kingdom and be strengthened as you take up responsibilities among the congregations of God's people. I want to preach this morning from the subtopic, If the Table Could Talk. If the Table Could Talk. I'm 30 years old, and I can remember growing up in the 90s, in the early 90s, as a 90s baby being raised with a table. When I say being raised with a table, I can remember the days and the time when it was important for families to gather around the table and share a meal. So often nowadays, we've become so inundated with busyness and life and cell phones and television and technology that we find ourselves forgetting about the significance of the table. Too often we don't sit around the table and share our meals as we did when I was raised. I can recall the countless meals that we would share as a family around the table, as I have 10 brothers and sisters, and 6 of them grew up in the same household with me. I can remember when my mother would gather us around the table, my grandmother would come and join us, and we'd talk about all of the experiences of our day. I can remember the time and the significance that our parents put into making sure that dinner was prepared and we were present at the table so that we all could prepare ourselves to eat. We couldn't just come in off the street. We couldn't just come in from outside and run to the table. But there was a specific amount of time that was placed in setting the table. Can I tell you that the significance of the table started long before our families started gathering at the table? The significance of the table started when it was initially just the altar. So often we mistake the altar as the chancel or the altar rail that surrounds the pulpit or protects the pulpit, but that's not the altar. The altar is the table that sits in front of the pulpit that has the Bible and the candles and the cross sitting on top of it. The altar is the table where we lay the Holy Communion, the Holy Eucharist, the communion that we share as we are reminded of the body and the blood of our Savior. It's at the table, which is the altar, that we first learn the significance of why we break bread together. Can I tell you the significance of the table started when sin entered into the world back in the book of Malachi in the Old Testament? And because sin had entered into the world, God found a substitute in order for us to be able to access redemption for our sins. It was the table, the altar where the early churchmen and the early members in the Bible would have to take over an animal and slay it on that table so that they would have remission for the mistakes or the sins that they had committed. Just like that table had lost its significance to them, at some point it's lost its significance to us today. The table lost its significance as Israel began to bring forth less than approved sacrifices for God. God, being frustrated, told Israel that you cannot bring me any old thing to my table. But when you come to the Lord's table, and when you come to bring a significance or a sacrifice to that table, it ought to be the best that you have to bring. My dear brother who preached before me, Reverend Christopher Evans, already talked about the Holy Communion and the bread and the wine. I'm just segueing that table to the significance of this Thanksgiving table. Can I preach it like I feel it today and tell you that so often we forget about the significance of the table? We have access to the table because when Jesus Christ died, we no longer have to slay an animal on the altar in order to have remission for our sins. But God sent his only begotten Son that we might have life and life more abundantly, that we might have access to him directly without having to sacrifice anything, because he sacrificed everything for us. On this Thanksgiving Day, I want to speak to some family members who have been struggling and fed up and tired and forgotten about the table. I want to speak to some families and some households who on this Thanksgiving Day for the first time may be dusting off the dining room table. We've taken the table for granted so much so that now all we do is decorate it up all nice and fancy and tell our children, "You bet not touch my good china sitting on the table." When did the table degrade itself so much that it has become just a fancy piece of furniture in the home where we are not even allowed to touch or engage with it anymore? When did the table become so insignificant in our lives that now all we do is pull up our TV dinners and everybody goes in the kitchen to grab their plates and goes their separate places in the home? This Thanksgiving Day, God is saying it's time to remind the significance of the table. It's at the table where families are being rebuilt. It's at the table where we can be reconnected to all that we've lost. It's at the table that there's a significance about what God can do and how God will move in our lives. You're probably saying, "Preacher, what's so significant about the table? Preacher, why are you talking about the table right now?" Can I tell you that it's at the table that Jesus decides to share his last meal with all of his disciples? It's at the table that Jesus sits there and begins to talk about and share life experiences and remind the disciples of the importance of what they shall be doing. It's at the table that Jesus takes this last opportunity to share a story and a parable or have a conversation with his disciples about how it is they shall govern themselves in his absence. It's at the table where Jesus is giving his farewell and his goodbye. It's at the table where Jesus is preparing them for his exit. It's at the table where Jesus is trying to remind the disciples of the significance of what he's getting ready to do. It's at this table, the Last Supper, where Jesus lays the foundation for what the significance of the altar shall be. It's at the table where Jesus breaks bread and shares in wine as he talks to the disciples about how they shall survive in his absence. And it's right there at the table where our text picks up, where the disciples forget about the breaking of the bread and the sharing of the wine that Jesus had just talked about, and begins to bicker and argue about which of them would be the greatest. It's at the table where Jesus takes on the task of educating and speaking life to his brothers, his disciples in this moment. It's at the table where Jesus pauses and begins to talk to them and remind them that it's not about being served, but it's about doing the service. My question to every family that's watching me today is, what service have you done for others in this season? Have you found yourself only focused and only worrying about yourself in this season? I recognize that we're in the midst of a pandemic. I recognize that we've been dealing with and struggling with so much over these last 9 months. I understand that the year 2020 is not what we expected or what we wanted it to be, but I just want to ask you, what does your table have to say about your life? We've been quarantined to our homes and we've been stuck on the inside for months on end. And my question is, if the table in your house could talk, if the dining room table or the kitchen table or the TV dinner tables that you pull out all the time, if the table could talk, What would the table say about your household? Would the table say that while I've been in this house for the last 9 months, I haven't heard any prayers? While we've been here, I've only seen and engaged in arguments. Will the table say that no one has broken bread around this table? No one has shared life experiences. No one has spoken life to each other. No one has come here and sat upon this table and allowed me to be the space of comfortability and the space for realness and the space for conversation. It's at the table where we're supposed to gather the family together and sit and break bread and learn and yearn and lean on one another. It's at the table where we have the foundation for how we shall govern ourselves and how we shall live and how we shall thrive through what we've been dealing with. It's at the table where young people can come and be honest with their parents and say, I've had a bad day. It's been a struggle for virtual learning for me. It's at the table where our parents shall be able to sit and listen to their children and hear the concerns of the household. It's at the table where fathers shall be able to come and fathers shall be able to sit as they speak life and lead their household. It's at the table where mothers spend hours preparing dinners and preparing the ground and setting the silverware and setting the table setting and placing the centerpieces of beauty so that the children have a sense of normalcy. It's at the table where Jesus is needed the most in your home. For it's at the table where we can discuss the challenges of our day. It's at the table where we can be honest, not just with ourselves, but with those around us who love us the most. It's at the table where we're supposed to engage with one another. If the table could talk in your house, would the table say that throughout this pandemic, we haven't even spoken to each other? If the table in your house could speak, would the table say that this is a home that's divided and in need of some change? This Thanksgiving, as you're preparing the turkey, preparing the dressing, I know somebody's auntie is making the potato salad or the macaroni and cheese. But if that's all you have at your table, you're missing the most important part. It's at the table where the family gathers for prayer. It's at the table where we are thankful for all that God has done in our lives. I've come to tell you today, just as Jesus told his disciples, it's at the table where you should not be so worried about being served, but how can I serve somebody else? We've been wondering when this pandemic is going to end. We've been wondering when it's going to be a shift in our lives. And I've come to tell you, it's at the table where there's a blessing waiting for you in this season. And if you're ready to hear the blessing and if you're ready to receive the thankfulness of what God has for you in this season, as you gather around the table today, this evening, this afternoon to share and to break bread, allow space, allow opportunity not to be petty, not to focus on who's not there, not to deal with what did not happen, not to talk about what cousin, what auntie, or what brother got a divorce, not to gossip, but it's at the table that God is looking for a family to gather in love, in charity, to gather in humility, and to gather in his name. It's at the table that God is saying, Lamone, remind the people this Thanksgiving that it all began with a table. The table that started as the altar but now is in every home. The table that's often built and made out of wood. The table that is usually of some antique value. The table that we often forget about and that we often overlook. It's the table that's significant to us today. Can I tell you, as I prepare to leave this place, that all I want to leave you with is, if the table could talk, what would the table have to say about your house? And that is that you ought to be careful who you invite to your table. You ought to be careful who you engage with. You ought to be careful who you break bread with and drink wine with. Jesus was reminding the disciples that they were sitting at the table not to be served, but to serve others. Jesus was reminding the disciples that it's the table where you ought to be grateful for all that he was getting ready to do. And as I prepare to leave this place, I want to remind you young people, and I want to remind you adults, and I want to remind you parents that it's a significance at the table, because when I was in, before I became a preacher full time, I can remember when I used to play football. And when I used to play football, I would always get excited for the big games, because my coach would always take us out before the game. He wouldn't wait till after the game like most coaches do. He always took us for the celebratory meal before the game. Why? Because he wanted us to know what it meant to give God thanks before the victory. And I want some family to know today who may be gathering around a table that does not have all that you're used to having. Maybe there's a family gathering around the table today and there's an empty chair for a family member who's not there, who normally would be sitting there. And I want to tell you that this is the pre-game meal, because the pre-game meal is where you give God thanks and glory in advance and you have not even won the victory yet. Somebody needs to give God glory and honor for the pre-game meal. I love the pre-game meal because it also gives you nourishment for the game that you have ahead of you. He would always take us to have a nice meal and then tell us to sit still and let it digest so that we were nourished and ready for the fight that was ahead of us. And I want to tell you that the pre-game meal is a reminder that no matter what's before you, you've already been prepared and you've already been fulfilled and you've already been revived for the fight. And so today, this Thanksgiving meal, you may still be in a war. You may still be in your turmoil. You may still be tired. You may still be depressed. You may still be dealing with anxiety. But just know this is just the pregame meal, and your victory is still on the way. And so while you break bread at the table today, be reminded that it was the table that held the sacrifice that you might be able to live and live life more abundantly. I'm ready to take my seat and I'm ready to get out of here, but I want to remind you today that it's a significance about the table. And even though you may not be at your victory place yet, even though we are still stuck in this pandemic, even though it looks like the world is retracting and we're going backwards, and our governors and our mayors are starting to close businesses back down, I want you to know, because we're sitting at a table, we have a reason to give God thanks. We have a reason to give God's name glory, and we have a reason to lift our hands right in our homes and share words of affirmation and confirmation and speak life around the table. And maybe you're saying, preacher, why should I tell God thank you when I'm still stuck in my brokenness and I'm still stuck in my pain? I'm still stuck in my pandemic. I'm still stuck in this same place. And I'm so glad you asked, and I want you to know that you should still give God thanks and be reminded of the table, because Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of your tender mercy did give your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death on the cross for our redemption, who made thereby his oblation of himself, once offered a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute in his holy gospel, command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death until his coming again. Oh, merciful Father, we must humbly beseech you and grant that we are receiving these your creatures of bread and wine according to your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, holy institution in remembrance of his death and passion, who in the same night that he was betrayed, he took bread and he gave thanks and he broke it. He took the cup, he gave thanks and he shared it. Preacher, why are you telling me to consecration for communion? Now, I'm telling you the consecration of communion to remind you that right after you break bread and drink wine and celebrate at the table, don't be like the disciples and start fussing and getting upset about what's going on and who's going to be greater. But focus on what you just observed and what you just partook in, and be reminded that you have a reason to give God's name glory and honor and praise, because Jesus was the master example of service to others. Even though he was betrayed the same week, he gathered the same people that lied on him, the same people that denied him, the same folk that overlooked him, and the same folk that did not believe in him. And he gathered them around the table and he fed them. And I've come to tell you that he is still your Savior and he still has a reason to be celebrated. I'm through, I'm finished, and I'm out of here. But on my way, I just got to give you your ABCs of Thanksgiving. And your ABCs of Thanksgiving is A, you ought to be reminded that he's the author and finisher of our faith. B, he is the bread of life. C, he is the chief cornerstone. D, he is our deliverer. E, he is our everlasting Father. F, he is the first and the last. G, he is the good shepherd. H, he is holy and acceptable. I, we still call him Emmanuel. J, his name shall always be Jesus. K, he is the King of Kings. L, he is the Lord of Lords. M, he is the Messiah. N, he is a Nazarene. O, he is our Savior. P, he is the Prince of Peace. Q, well, he's quite the Redeemer. R, he is our rock and of our salvation. S, he is the Son of God. T, he is the truth. U, he is an unmatched man. V, he is the victorious vine. W, he is the word of the word, and the word lives in him. X, he is excellent. Y, he is your bright and morning star. And Z, he is still Zion's healer. And because I have 26 reasons to tell God thank you, you ought to open your mouth in your home right now. Throw your head back and say, for God I live and for God I die. Even though I'm stuck at this Thanksgiving table and I may not be where I want to be, I still have a reason to tell him thank you. Lift up your hands right in your home and say, God, I thank you. I thank you that the table will not talk negative of me, but if the table could talk, the table would say that I'm humble and I'm grateful. If the table could talk, the table would say that this home and this place is the place where I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praises shall continually be in my mouth. If the table could talk, the table would say that this is a home that has been covered in the blood of Jesus. And because of that, we are blessed beyond measure, and we're grateful to be gathered together again, whether on Zoom or whether in person. This is still the day that the Lord has made. Happy Thanksgiving. God bless you and God keep you.
Happy Thanksgiving, everyone. I praise God for this opportunity to close out the series of messages based in the Gospel of Luke, chapter number 22. Today, my assignment is to preach verses number 31 and 32 as we close out this particular pericope in the ministry of Jesus Christ. Verses number 31 and 32 say, Simon, Simon, Satan desires to sift you as wheat, but I have prayed for you, Peter, that your faith may not fail. And when thou hast been converted, turn back and strengthen your brethren. Today, in this Thanksgiving season, in this moment of praise, of family and fellowship, I want to make this bold declaration. A shift is coming. Let's get ready to close out this Thanksgiving message today. A shift is coming. During this season of Thanksgiving, one of the most important things that I've tried my best to impress upon the community of believers here in High Springs is that Thanksgiving is more than just a day to celebrate, but Thanksgiving is a day to be reflective and to give God praise over the fact that, one, we've made it this far along the way. True Thanksgiving is a result of when you are able to sit in a place and be able to give God glory, knowing that he is the only reason why you've made it to where you are. And as we've come through this place, and as we've come through 11 and a half, almost 12 months of 2020, I'm a witness that we've come through a whole lot. We've come through racial injustice. We've come through a strange political season. We've come through the coronavirus. And let's tell the truth, we've lost some things this year. We've lost some loved ones. We've lost money. We've lost jobs. And we've lost some real genuine connections. But even in the midst of everything that we may have lost, I'm celebrating the fact that the Lord has allowed me to maintain a few things. First thing I want to give God glory for is the fact that I'm still here. And in the midst of me still being here, I have to give God glory for what I have. Because my problem is sometimes we spend so much time grieving and lamenting over what's been lost that we refuse to give God glory over what we still have left. So in essence, my family and friends, I want you to remember that Thanksgiving is about not necessarily reflecting or lamenting about what has been lost or what's been so jacked up today. I want you to stop and give God glory for what you still have. But my brothers and sisters, even as we move throughout this day, as you stop and give God glory for what you have, I also want you to take a real peek into your spiritual future and begin to praise God right now for what's coming next. Because the mark of the real mature believer is not necessarily just to be able to praise God for what you have or to be able to praise God for what you've lost. The Bible tells us that faith is what's hoped for in the midst of evidence that of some stuff that we can't see yet. And so my family and friends, as believers, today I challenge you to begin to celebrate the fact that God is getting ready to show us this Thanksgiving some freshness and some newness, and eyes have not seen nor have ears heard the greatness that is going to be coming out of your life at the end of this year. So my brothers and sisters, this message today, these two verses that have been assigned to me, we're talking about the Lord ushering us into a divine shift. Because in the midst of everything that's been happening at this table, my brothers have already preached about the trouble in the room, about the trouble at the table, and about the significance of the bread and the wine. But my brothers and sisters, instead of dealing with the mayhem at the table as it relates to Jesus and all of the disciples, my assignment is to look at what happened specifically between Jesus and Peter, because this is an isolated conversation and it's not necessarily connected to everybody who was sitting at the table. My family and friends, this message that you're getting from me is directly from God's mouth to my ears to your heart, because the Lord wants you to know today that the Lord is getting ready to shift you. No, this message ain't for your mama. This ain't for your family. The word I've got is straight for you, because before the end of this year, God is going to get ready to supernaturally shift everything that has been hindering you. God is getting ready to supernaturally shift some stumbling blocks that have been in your way. Before the end of this year, if you give God praise for it, God will get ready to shift the atmosphere and allow some things to line up for you that you didn't even know was on your horizon. And so my family and friends, today, before we get to the shift, we have to understand that every time God gets ready to strategically bless us, Satan always comes sniffing around and he wants to try to mess up a good thing. And so that's exactly what's happening here in this text, because Jesus is sitting at the table and he's telling Peter, Satan desires to sift you as wheat. The word sift simply translates to mean that he wants to separate Peter from Jesus. And my brothers and sisters, the enemy's main objective, according to the Gospel of John, is to steal, kill, and destroy. And my brothers and sisters, the enemy will try to sift you and separate you in every aspect of your life. And when the Lord is in your life, the enemy tries to do everything he can to get up under your skin. That's why certain people pop up out of nowhere. That's why you keep having the same issue over and over and over again. That's why every time
time you think that you've just gotten over one issue, here comes another, because the enemy is simply sifting you, and he's doing everything he can to make you cuss. He's doing everything he can to make you throw in the towel. But my brothers and sisters, I've got good news for you. Satan is a sifter, but Jesus is a shifter. And I declare and decree that after the enemy gets through with his season of sifting, the Lord is about to bring you into a shift so major that you won't even be able to remember what the enemy has done to you. And so, my brothers and sisters, in this text in verse number 31, the Bible says that Jesus tells Peter, Satan desires to sift you as wheat. But the Bible says that Jesus says, but I've prayed for you, Peter, that your faith will not fail you. Ain't it a good feeling to know that in the midst of trials and tribulation, that the Lord is on your side? And not only is he on your side, but he's praying for you. And my family and friends, when God is praying for you, when Jesus, the paraclete, when our big brother who walks right alongside of us, when he's spiritually interceding for us, there's no way we can let the Lord down. So he says, Peter, I'm praying that your faith will not fail you. I'm not saying that you won't fail. I'm not saying that you won't have some bad days. I'm not saying that you won't slip and fall, but I'm praying that your faith will not fail you, because there's still some blessings left with your name on it. Because my brothers and sisters, Jesus knew that after Peter had been sifted, he will ultimately be shifted if he just held on and waited for his change to come. I've got to get out of here now, but my brothers and sisters, I want to let you know that this is the season on this divine Thanksgiving day that the Lord is getting ready to end the sifting that's been going on in 2020. I'm coming to put the enemy on notice that after the shift is about to happen. And as a result of the shift comes with a couple of things. With the shift comes affirmation. And out of affirmation comes confirmation. And out of the confirmation, we get declaration. And today, my declaration is your liberation, because the Lord is getting ready to set us free. And I declare and decree that the shift is happening in our communities. The shift is happening in your house. The shift is happening every time you turn around, because the Lord ain't through with us yet. I wish I had somebody to lift up your hands and say right now, I declare a shift over my house. I declare a shift over my money. I declare a shift in my church. I declare a shift in my body. Is there anybody watching this that says, shift me, Lord? I'm tired of being stuck in this place. Shift me, Lord. I'm tired of dealing with no good enemies. Shift me, Lord. I'm tired of being in the same place, complacent all the time, mad all the time. Is it anybody watching this that's saying, Lord, shift me? At the end of this text, the Bible says that Peter, when the shift is happening, I don't want you to just come out by yourself, but he says, when you come out of the shift, I want you to turn back and strengthen your brothers, because at the end of the day, you've got to know that the blessing ain't just for you, but the blessing is for everybody who you're connected to. Bye-bye, y'all. Happy Thanksgiving. But I want to let you know that I'm coming out and I'm bringing you with me. The Lord is setting us free. The Lord is shifting our minds. The Lord is shifting our hearts. Do you know him? Have you tried him? Won't he make a way? Do you know him? Have you tried him? Won't he make a way? The shift is coming. The shift is coming.
Amen, amen, and amen. I pray that this service has been a blessing to you, and I'm praying that this has resonated with your hearts, your minds, and your soul.
We see in Luke chapter 22, verses 39 through 53, we see the power of prayer. We see Jesus, who's the Son of God, Jesus, who's fed a multitude and raised the dead and casted out demons and turned water into wine. Jesus, our Lord and Savior, is in a moment of prayer and had to receive strength. It's important to understand that no matter who you are, we all need to cry out to God once in a while. And so today, in this moment, you might have received an invitation to go to somebody's Thanksgiving dinner or virtually on Zoom, and you might be sitting there, and we know that that invitation will only be for Thursday and Friday and maybe a little bit for the weekend. But I'm here to extend to you an invitation that will change your life. I'm here to extend to you an invitation that when you accept it, there is no expiration date. That this invitation declares eternal life. And so if you're sitting there and you're asking the question of how can I be saved? How can I get to know this man? How can I have a relationship with God? This invitation is for you. But not only that, if you're asking God, oh, I need a church home. I just need to be in a place. This invitation is for you. But maybe you're sitting here and you feel like the prodigal son, and you left home and you've been out in the world, and you're asking God, listen, I need to turn my life back into you. I need to come home and I got to rededicate my life. This invitation is for you. And you might be saying, Brittany, listen, I have a church and I've accepted Jesus as my Lord and Savior. I know who he is. I've been to Bible studies and Sunday schools, but something ain't right. There's something going on with me and I just need prayer. And I need some strength, even like Jesus. This invitation is for you. So right now, we want to pray for you. I want to pray for your businesses. I want to pray for your books. I want to pray for your vision. I want to pray for you breaking generational curses. I want to pray for you receiving degrees. I want to pray for your brokenness. I want to pray for when you feel lost. I want to pray when you feel lonely. I just want to pray on your behalf. So let's go in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, God, we thank you. We thank you, God, on this Thanksgiving Day, God. We thank you for allowing us to have breath in our bodies. God, you didn't have to do it, but you did, and we got to tell you thank you. God, we thank you for the food that's on the table, and it might not be what we wanted, but God, we still got to tell you thank you. Thank you, God, for allowing us to watch this service, God. Thank you for feeding our minds and feeding our souls, God, and feeding our bodies. So, God, in the name of Jesus, we pray for every person on this live. God, we pray for every person that needs a breakthrough. We pray for every person, God, that needs to just know you in a relationship with you, God. And we're asking you in the name of Jesus to grant them salvation. God, we're praying for the people that need a church home, that just need a covering, God. We pray, God, for people who need to rededicate their life to you, and God, who just need to know that they can come home. And God, we're praying in the name of Jesus, every person that needs some type of prayer. God, we're praying for our burdens that we keep carrying. God, we're praying that we just lay it on the side, every worry, God, that we have, and every doubt, God, that we have, and everything that we continue to carry with us. just because of what society says. But God, we are casting it out in the name of Jesus. God, we're not just thankful for our families, God, and not just thankful for the food that's on the table, but God, we thank you for being an almighty and all-powerful God. God, we're asking you to deliver us from our sins. God, we're asking you to erase it in the name of Jesus and grant us grace and mercy. We pray, God, for the preachers that have preached, God. We pray for their families, God. We pray for their ministries, God. We ask you to cover them in the name of Jesus. God, we're praying for a person who just needs to know a little bit more about you. God, we're praying for the person that continues to cry in their room and they're crying out to you, God, but they're putting on their mask when they go outside. God, we're praying for you to heal people on the inside and heal people on the outside. God, we know that we serve a healer. God, we know that we serve a deliverer. God, we know that when we call out on your name, God, there's something about your name that when we call on the name of Jesus, God, we know the mountains will fall. God, we know that when we call you in the name of Jesus, blessings shall fall. We know that, God, when we cry out to you, we see that a shift will happen. So, God, in the name of Jesus, every prayer request that might be written in the comments or might be written in our hearts or wherever they are, God, we want to lift them to you. We lift our visions, God. We lift our life. And we decree and declare it that it shall be done. We thank you, God, for everything that you continue to do in our life. And God, as we end this prayer, but we never leave your presence. We seal this prayer, God, with the blood that was shed on Calvary's cross. And we'll be ever so more careful, God, to give you all the glory, to give you all the honor, and to give you all the praise and thanksgiving. And this we ask, God, in your precious name. We say amen, amen, and amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. God, the Holy Spirit, rest, rule, and abide with you now, henceforth, and forevermore. Say amen.